So we will, we'll get underway, and let's, I'll say a prayer together, and then we will get started. So, loving God, we give you thanks for this this time together, for this class, for worship already yesterday and today, and for worship which is coming up, and help us to see our whole lives are worship, and that our whole lives are stewardship, and our whole lives are yours, because in you we live and move and breathe and have our being. Help us to see that as our worth, and believing that, help us to see the world with your eyes. It's in your name we pray, and all God's children said,
Amen. Amen.
So today, we've actually got a fair number of things to go over, and so the first thing was a review, and the first 2 weeks ago, we talked about the history of a very quick thing about what it means to be a Christian, kind of the essentials. That is a huge, huge, huge thing, and we gave it 50 minutes. So, any questions about that? Yes, sir.
This is a question I should have asked last week, but I'm reading the brochure, and it says about the resurrection. We're a Presbyterian. The resurrection of the body refers to the reuniting of the spiritual body and the physical body. Now, if somebody is burned at the stake, on a more likely today, what does that mean?
That's a very good question. So when the Bible, the question was asked is talking about the resurrection, and we talk about bodily resurrections. So the, you know, there's the question of if somebody were cremated or somebody burned at the stake. I had a friend in Joplin, had to do his service. He died in a plane crash, when his plane went down. And he was, and it was ashes, right, at that point. And so the scriptures tell us that when Jesus rose from the dead, that it was not a just a spiritual resurrection. There was a body that was there. And so it is partly a mystery because, but yet when Jesus was raised from the dead, it was a body, but it was not, it was something that was new. Something that was renewed, because if you think about it, when Jesus was in the garden, who's the first, this is a good question, who is the first person that Jesus revealed himself as a as resurrected? Sorry, who was the first person to whom did he do that? Mary. This is another great reason, frankly, why we have women leadership in the church. Because sometimes folks say, well, Paul said this, we're fine with Paul. Paul had his own self in that own church at that own time. However, Jesus gave the first message of the resurrection to Mary. You know what Jesus told Mary? Go tell the disciples. So the this is the whole point of resurrection. All things are new. So where it was a patriarchal thing, more or less, looking at the Old Testament, kind of coming through, you say, well, there are 12 men disciples. You have in the resurrection on Easter morning, you have something new happen, which is really a very cool thing. But Mary at first did not recognize him, right? She mistook him for the, anyone, Bueller? The gardener. The gardener. She thought he was, and everybody, that's the point. When Jesus came, something happened with that resurrection that not everybody could recognize him at first. Even with the miraculous catch of fish. And before Peter gets reinstated, they didn't really recognize Jesus. There was something about when Jesus, though, says your name, they started to recognize him. So it is, it's a bit of a mystery to me, honestly, but it is a new body at some way resembling the old. But that's the question always of, it comes from, I said Elijah a couple weeks ago, Ezekiel with the Valley of Dry Bones, bones coming together, and that vision, that's a vision. So we believe that there is, and we say that in the Apostles' Creed, right? We said we believe in the resurrection of the body. And so there's something, but that's I can teach a semester on that. Every time I start talking, I start studying, I'm like, okay, that's a rabbit trail, that's good, but we don't have time to go. That's a great question. Other questions? That was a good one. Okay, last week we talked about the Presbyterian Church, the Reformed tradition. That's only the last, 500 years. So, any questions about that, or do we have it all down? One thing, I don't know if we talked about last week, but important to remember to mention is with the sacraments we have. We have baptism and we have the Lord's Supper. We believe in the Presbyterian Church, there is the sign and the thing signified in that. So in baptism, the sign is water, right? And so you have water, the element, earthly element there. And the thing signified to water is, what do we do before we do wash? It is the washing. So the water is just common water. There's nothing that makes that water holy outside of God and exalted. It is that water is the washing away of sins. It's also for anointing, for the cleaning of our lives. So the sign is water. The thing signified is being part of something. The church would also be made clean by death and resurrection. Now, we have the Lord's Supper at the 8:30 service every week. What are the two signs in that? The bread and the cup, right? The bread, grape juice or wine. I've only been to one church. My church in Alabama, we had wine. And before everyone goes, well, that's great. It was watered down manischewitz. You got to make that $4 bottle of wine last. And we also had white grape juice that was there as well. But so the sign there, though, is just as bread feeds our bodies, we're trusting that this bread is also feeding our souls. Just as the wine or grape juice is refreshing, it is also refreshing, renewing our souls as well. In the Roman Catholic tradition, we did not talk about this, did we? I don't think we talked about this last week. But in the Roman Catholic tradition, they believe something happens called transubstantiation. And so, for those of you who grew up Roman Catholic, there's the point where in the priest and prayer, there is where the elements are changed from bread and wine to the body and blood of Christ. You would have heard this before, right? So that is called transubstantiation. So that is a view in the Roman Catholic Church. A lot of churches have different views on it. A lot of churches in our area that are Baptist or non-denominational, they will have what's called a strict memorial view of this, because it is they believe that all that happens in the Eucharist is that we're supposed to remember, because remember Christ said, "Do this in remembrance of me." The Lutheran Church, Martin Luther would say to that, he would say, hoc est. Does anybody ever take Latin? Hoc est. What does hoc est mean? Anybody know? This is. I'm not going to do my Lutheran. I'm a little stuffed up, so maybe I could. Hoc est. But this is. So you have in Jesus, in the words of institution, he says, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So the Lutherans have what's called ubiquity, is that Christ is in everything, so he's going to be in this blood, cup and bread as well. And others are strict memorialism. What the Reformed understanding of this is that it's a spiritual feeding. And just as bread feeds your bodies, communion bread feeds your souls. But more than that, one of the really cool things, I think, about communion, because it's a holy mystery. Sacraments are literally mysteries. When we take communion, we're not just taking communion at 10 or 11 15 on a Sunday morning here at 601 Claymont Drive in Baldwin, Missouri. We're taking it with the Church Universal. And that is the church of everybody who's taking it that day, but it's also with everybody who's going to take it that afternoon in their homes, or everybody who has taken it before us, everyone who's going to take it afterwards. Because it is not just a, we're supposed to remember, we trust we're also being fed, but also it is a foretaste, an appetizer of the heavenly wedding banquet. And it's supposed to say like, so I think heaven's going to put that idea of saying where food is provided. We're going to talk about the Giving Thanks dinner a little bit in church, and that's next week. Here, we have a lot of food. There's no charge for it. The only thing we ask is that people bring cans. So this is the best illustration of the church I can think of. The meal is already prepared. It's already ready for you. The question is, do you come? And also, how do you pass along that blessing in the form of bringing canned goods for other people? But that's the church. That's the good news. So that, there's such rich sacramental theology. And a lot of churches say, well, it's too complex, or it's too hard to explain, so let's get rid of it. And I'm like, no, it's the good stuff. It is the good stuff, and the deep and rich stuff. So I will say this one church I went to when I was in college, I think I might have mentioned, I won't mention the names, because some of you went to school in Columbia, and that church is still there. So I'll say this, it was off Nikon. And so I went to the Methodist church. I was Methodist at the time, did not feel like the church at home that I loved, which I really loved. And so I started church shopping. And eventually I made my way back to the Methodist, the Presbyterian church. But I went to this church. The first Sunday, I was like, man, that sermon's great. Second Sunday, I'm like, yeah, it's still a good sermon. Third Sunday, I was like, fourth Sunday, I was like, he preached the same sermon 4 weeks in a row. I'm like, what in the world? Now, that church was what we call more of a seeker-friendly church. Like, it's always trying to, but that's not why it's like that church. They did at one point this thing where they did bread, like got breadsticks from Olive Garden and grape soda, and they did communion once a year, and they did that just kind of show it doesn't really matter. And that was like, you know, because it matters. It matters. But it more than that, it matters to understand what we're doing and to talk about that. These are holy mysteries.
Yeah, you have to ask the question. It's so important. There's only two sacraments. Why don't you do it in every service?
Well, and that's it's a fantastic question. The reason we do it at this was all put before I got here, but I like the way we do it. The 8:30 service is so if you want to have communion every week, there's a service for you. The idea, though, is that you want to have it often enough where people can be fed. But there was the belief that you don't want to have it happen so often that it becomes just routine and you're not thinking about how special it is. Now, we live in that tension, that balance, but it's a very good point because, you notice there are different things that are symbolized. If you pass the plates, you know, the offering trays, and you get that, there's something to be said about Christ meeting you where you're at, right? But if we come forward and we rip and dip, right, and do the tension, what's called it. And we do that. There's also something special about saying, I'm going to come forward. Right? So everything, I'll say this, everything is stewardship, everything is theological, everything is spiritual. That's how we look at it. When Jesus told stories, what did he do? He said he picked up a mustard seed. Or he said, see those workers in the field. And he would tell a story. Like, he would take the most ordinary things. Things that now we're like, oh my gosh, it's so profound. But he took the ordinary, the secular, and he said, this too is sin. That's how we see it. We've got two questions. We're cooking with gaps. Any other questions?
Seminary slang.
I don't know. I think I started saying that about 3 years ago. I didn't realize, look at what line like was going like. About 1.5 million other posts online where they call Urban Dip, so it's not me. Clearly, I heard it at some point, and I claim it as my own. And then with the press tree,
just a quick question. I've only been here when you were doing the communication. You also do the passing.
They have the passes. I think it's been a little while since we've done the pass in place, but we have them. And so at some point, I think we'll do it again, but it's just a, it's, we between the two, I prefer intention personally, because I like the idea of coming forward. I also like the idea of specifically looking somebody in the eye and saying, this is Christ's body broken and his blood shed. In Joplin, when we passed the plates, we would have everybody hold until the end, and then we would say those words. What? It is. And I would say, one of the reasons I like to do it, I think the best sound in the church, outside of a baby crying in church. And you laugh at that, but that means there's a baby in church. Right? Is the best sound is the little shot glasses. And after everyone's done, they've all taken together, and it sounds like rain. That's what they do. They put the little plastic cups and the little holders. Oh, it's like grace, right? It's like I'm serious. It's awesome. I love it. Gosh, three questions. We have a four. Auctioneer. Well, staff, St. Mark Presbyterian Church, history was, you know, a lot of what happened with St. Mark is the history of what happened with West County St. Louis. And so we've got a whole book that was put together for the 50th anniversary. It's a great book. It's helped me out a lot because I get to read through it. And like I said, I love history. It's fun to read how much the romance costs. That's the parsonage, the home of the pastors. It's fun to know that kind of stuff. So the presbytery bought this land and actually some more land. The church used to have more land, but they bought it and there was nothing really out here. And so the church met for a while, and eventually they bought the manse before they built the church, if I recall the first building. And they would have meetings, because you live in them. Because the manse.
I live in
the
manse.
Yeah, you live, it's your house. So if you want to know more, Sharon will do a house tour coming up. Look to the right of church.
Oh, yeah, right. It's not a good idea today.
But this, and so eventually, so you have the fellowship hall that was built first, which was the first, and then they quickly outgrew that. And then the gym was built before the second sanctuary, right? Or the second sanctuary. Yeah. So the gym, then you have the second sanctuary, which is the world's largest narthex. That's a huge narthex. And then the current sanctuary being built in the late 80s, early 90s. And so then there are office, various building things that. But one of the reasons St. Mark grew, because I just learned that this week, there were three churches that were planted about the same time. One of those churches was born, one of those churches merged with another church. And so one of the reasons St. Mark grew is because it was intentional about reaching out. It was intentional about meeting the neighbors and that kind of thing. And I think there's really a whole lot of new under the sun. I think, the reason I think some people come to church is because somebody invited them. Or they come to church and because they felt welcome. And then someone said hello to them. And somebody was there. They were kind. You know, I think, and there's follow-up, and you start to come to church. To come to church, and I'm glad you all have, because, especially for the first time, it's a bold step to walk into a church. I went to, before my first Sunday here, went to a church that was in, I won't say which one, but I always like to see what other churches do. And so I went to a large church, relatively close, and outside of the person who was charged with greeting at the door, nobody else said hello. And you know, I've been ordained for a while, and I felt there. And there's also something I liked about the church. I think they just sums up well, but I felt even if the worship was great, if you don't feel welcome, you're not going to come back. And I think St. Mark was intentional about that. So the pastoral leadership, and also I think one of the strengths here is lay leadership at St. Mark. I think we've got a lot of a history of a lot of quality elders and deacons, and also folks who just are doers. And so I think that's been a thing. And it's strange for me talk about this stuff, because for a lot of you, you've been worshiping here much longer than I have been here. So if you want to pipe in, welcome to. But this comes back to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 27. Now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. We're not lying when we're saying that this is a central thing about being Presbyterian, is about being a Christian, is saying we believe in the priesthood of all believers, that each one of you have unique gifts. Does anybody understand? inhibitions are gone. You're singing, you're asking questions. But there's a verse in there that says, if you can't, was it, if you cannot preach like Peter, you cannot pray like Paul, you can tell the love of Jesus who died to save us all, or something like that. So that's the point. I love that thing because it just says, like, you don't have to be Peter. And you don't have to be Paul. You have to be you. And you all are fearfully and wonderfully made. That together we are stronger than the sum of our parts. When we add our gifts together, that those things are multiplied. And that, for me, is exciting. That's something that gets me excited about the church. That's one of the things I get excited about when I'm being with. Because I can't sing. I love to sing. And I told you this, I think my high school choir director at church said, you know, it's always said, make a joyful noise, but then he used to tell me, but not necessarily that loud. It's okay. That's why Katie didn't sit by the So that's what we're talking about with membership and following, if the email everyone got or not, but following the worship, 10:30 worship service, we're going to be in room 102, which is the session room for the chance for, it's called an examination, which sounds really scary. It's not really an examination. It's more a chance just to talk and to get to know one another for folks who want to join the church and unite their ministries with us here at St. Mark. And so that is then maybe about 10, 15 minutes and be out by noon, but the session had a chance to vote. And then for those folks who have said yes, then we would want next week to recognize and introduce you in front of the church. And then we'll give you thanks that are following the member class, giving thanks that are following the worship service as a chance for other people to greet you. So, not wholly different than the installation service, you know, where there's a chance just to welcome people. We have a few things, and we have some presentations or some times, we've got elders here who are going to talk, and so some folks can't be here, some staff folks, because they're teaching confirmation and doing other things. So our children's ministry is here. We're going to talk to them too.
Morning, I'm Elizabeth Oglesby. I'm the elder for children's ministry. We have a very active children's program. We have Sunday school for our children every Sunday. It normally follows right after our time with children. And we go to the back part, back by the fellowship hall for their classes. And then we have what we call Wednesday night fellowship for our kids. And it actually has two parts to it. At 6:15 on Wednesday nights, our children who would like to sing in our children's choir come down, and they are led by Pastor Susan, and they come and sing, do some work on some songs that they eventually end up performing in church for us on a Sunday. That's coming up December 10th. In fact, you will get to see them perform next Sunday because they're doing the blessing for the Thanks Dinner. And then the second half, they come back and they get a small little lesson from a program we're using called Holy Moly, which the kids absolutely love. If you ever see any of our kids running around the church, ask them about Holy Moly. They will be more than happy to tell you about it. They come, we normally bring them in and have some kind of mission activity for them. Currently, right now, we are working on some stuff for our homebound members. They'll be working on that last week and this week, as well as some stuff that several of us actually take out to our homebound members then later. And then they normally have a game they play that goes along with the story of the small snack. Once a month, we have what's called successful in pet lesson. We have our kids do a pet lesson as well once a year. So it's a lot of fun. We would love to have your children come in, and grandchildren. We love all kids.
We have some stuff here next to the youth group and pictures and I can talk about it.
Good morning, friends. Thank you so much for being here. Liz was mentioning that second Sunday event for our kids that's called Saints. You might want to add to your calendar Sunday, December 10th, where the kids will be serving pancakes and we're going to have brunch with Santa. And your presenter this morning might be in a red suit, just saying. I have a couple minutes to talk about the youth committee. Katie is downstairs. Katie Sternhagen, our youth director, is downstairs teaching confirmation now. These are some of the particulars about our youth ministry here at St. Mark. Probably the most important thing that we are interested in with our kids, especially when we take them on trips to some of the conferences and activities hosted by our denomination, is that they begin to form a Presbyterian identity, that is a PCUSA identity, so that when kids and other people in their walk ask them, what church do you go to and why, they're able to sort of explain what it means to be one of us. We have confirmation class for 7th and 8th grade. We go in the summer to the annual Montreat Youth Conference in North Carolina, and every 3 years there's a huge Presbyterian Youth Triennium at Purdue University. Our high school youth group fellowship meets on Sunday afternoons, and our middle school on Wednesday evenings. The other thing that we try to do with all of our committees in the church is build relationships. What we know about our youth and children is that if there is an adult who wonders what the score was on the soccer game or how they did on a test, they're more interested in coming to church when they know that one of you care that they show up here. So that's kind of one of the things we as adults can do is keep a look at our kids. Do you want to
we'll get back to this little scene, make sure everybody gets through. And then, deacons, have you been here to talk about deacons?
Our deacons, their main focus and mission is caregiving for our congregation, our community, and the world. We have an awesome caregiving ministry where we have people who prepare meals and take them to folks who can't get out. We have, you've noticed the caregiving cards that we sign for our members who are in hospital or, you know, otherwise can't get to church or just to let folks know that we love and care about them. Right now, we're looking at a new ushering ministry through our deacons. So if that's something that you would like to do or that you're interested in hearing more about, let us know. Our deacons do a lot of stuff. And they do some big fundraisers throughout the year. They do the golf tournament in the spring or summer for Circle of Concern, which is our food ministry in Valley Park. And the deacons also do the ABC sale, which is a big garage sale, rummage sale that we have in the summer. Those monies, upwards of $10,000, go to our charitable partners in the community. So that's what that's about. And when you start seeing information about the ABC sale, it's also a way to gather together, to work together, and it's just plain fun. But at the end of the day, those monies go to our charitable partners.
Awesome. Thank you.
Sit on the edge.
Yeah. Well, the next one I know is Bertha.
I'm with Adult Christian Education, and of course we have offerings for Sunday school. We have three classes going on now. We invite you to look at what's being offered in the bulletin because it tells you what they're studying, and they all meet at 9:30, so it's right between the two services. So it's easy for people to kind of fit it in if they come at 8:30 or at 10:30 service. The thing that I'm most passionate about, though, are the small groups. Now, some of us old folks here that have been here at the church for a while are members of small groups. And what it is it's like not more than 12 people in a group meet together, study the word, socialize, and just really enjoy each other's company. We didn't all know each other that well when we started out in our small groups, but as you meet, you start liking and loving each other, and of course, supporting and caring for each other too. Some of us are in groups. So I started a group, shepherd a group, and I couldn't leave it, so I just stayed with the second group. So, and this has been going on since the 80s, but we, every couple of years, we make that offering, the small group. If you're interested, we get together, and you get together, and kind of get your group together to just meet and fellowship. And you grow. You grow in your whole understanding and love for Christ. So I invite you in the new year to look for our little blurb and bulletin, and hopefully some of you will consider it.
And now your practice is coming in.
Yes, you're already here. You're already used to come here at 9:30. But it's the one thing I don't want St. Mark to be is ever anonymous. And that when I say anonymous, I don't want anybody to come and not have a connection with somebody else. That's, we're large enough where we have a lot of programs that go on, but I also want us to always be intentional about when we ask, there's someone in the church that can ask and say, what's going on? How are you doing with this? You know, and Susan kind of touched on that with talking with the kids. But also, you know, I think one of the best prayers you can ever have with God is, may it be the real you to whom I pray, and may it be the real me who's praying. And saying, like, this is the place to be real with each other and to have that kind of connection. Those are the people that, those people God puts in our life. If we're blessed, who you know, we don't have to get changed when we come over to our house. You know what I mean? That we're just real. You know, so we're not close enough friends yet. The chain of records pop over to the old man.
Anytime.
Brian is going to touch base a little bit. This is Stewardship Sunday. It's Stewardship Saturday. It's Stewardship Weekend. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Brian Sprague. I've had the privilege now with the fourth pastor to be involved with stewardship. And what's fun about it is it's not my program, it's collaboration with the staff and what we're being called to do from a stewardship standpoint. If you're not Presbyterian or if you're not St. Mark, what we prefer to do and need to do is to understand what our pledge is from the members going into the new year. Because Session obviously takes that money. They don't just pick a number, last year's budget or 2 years ago budget. They really take a look at what's been pledged because we have to live within our means. There's no faith budget. There's a lot of faith that goes on, obviously, but we need to make sure that we live within our means so that we can do the work that God's called us to do. I assume that non-members haven't received Didn't you see the letter like this? Did you get one? Some of you maybe didn't. Liz, would you pass those around? I'll take the privilege of passing those around. I know that you're not members yet, but I want to make sure that you get what the members received, which was a letter from Dave, as well as a pledge card that is for today, and any time that you have prayerfully considered what is your giving for the new year. So that's what we do within stewardship and part of church support that I've been privileged to be a part of. Raise your hand if you need one, please. Liz, you get your back to this. You'll hear from Liz. I don't want to stand between Liz, who's going to talk about another topic. So, if you have questions regarding stewardship, regarding pledging, over here, Liz, a couple. I hang around. I'm here all the time. So, thank you much.
Thanks, man.
Prayerfully consider what God has called you to do.
And this is the reminder, when I say everything, I keep saying, you'll hear me say it at least two times in the service today, probably more, everything is stewardship. What we do with our time is stewardship, like the day, 24 hours that God gives you, that's stewardship. What we do with our talents, our skills, what we do with our financial resources, all these things are stewardship. It probably, one of my goals is to make sure that we are not just talking about stewardship three Sundays a year. Because we need to be reminded in February about stewardship and how we live our lives. I always tell people, every budget is a moral document. So a church budget is a moral document. Our family budgets are moral documents. Government budgets are moral documents because they're saying, these are the things that matter most to me. And so, if you have any questions, feel free. A little work I did in the outside world before I went to seminary was in MBNA America, which is Bank of America. And I worked in the credit card industry. I know, exciting, right? Tell me more, Dave. I got to a point where I would, you start looking at spreadsheets enough, and you know, it's we're going to talk about what it means to plan and what it means to be intentional. And that's one thing that Presbyterians, we believe the Spirit moves best through structure. And that sounds weird, but it's, I would say again, the Spirit moves best through structure. That's why we have a liturgy. That's why we plan, and that's why we always are looking ahead. M&E.
So, one of the reasons that you're here is because MB has a new members class. And what we do is we look for opportunities to contact people to bring them into our fellowship. But we do more than that. We look for those evangelistic opportunities. We do the pictorial directory. We monitor the church roles and a number of other things like that. But we really are all about reaching out to get members to come in. And so if you have a burden on your heart that would like to bring you in to help us do that, we were always looking for new committee members.
And I had woman from the 8:30 service come and talk to me following worship, and she said, I just had neighbors who moved in across the street, and I went over and talked to them about St. Mark.
And that is,
she says, is that all right? I'm like,
yes.
Absolutely. We'll talk about it later, but I get a wash of people with, but this is the point, is that she's asking about youth. She's asking about, and that's one thing that we as Presbyterians need to work better at, is what I call our elevator speeches. And saying the reason, in 30 seconds, 45 seconds, say the reason I love St. Mark, or the reason I go to church is. And to say, the best answer, frankly, is because I'm loved there. It's because I'm loved there and I'm fed. Evangelism has been described as one starving person telling another starving person where they found bread. I think that's really interesting. Well, communications, we might have had a miscommunication. Sorry. So communications, dad jokes. It newsletter, bulletin, the web with Facebook and our church homepage, our website. So we think it's also important to be intentional about making sure those things are as professional and informative as possible. I think we do a very good job here. Worship and worship. So we don't have a set committee about that, but again, worship is with the liturgy. There's a set purpose for why we do things. The liturgy sometimes can feel restrictive, you know, but the reason we have everything in worship is meant to be intentional. And I'm going to do two more slides on fellowship. Hello, fellowship. And can I get you to fast forward this? Because I got to put a robe on. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, you got to hit press an arrow. Because, and so I apologize after. Well, I'm not apologizing. That's good.
I'll go tell the congregation you'll be there in a few minutes.
Yeah.
So fellowship is one of those committees. Oh, here we go.
Thank you, Sharon. I'm Liz Sprague, and I am on the party committee. It's really called the fellowship committee, but we have a blast. And we run a lot of the event, we organize a lot of the events that many of you will want to take part in. Coffee every Sunday. Someone from our committee hosts coffee, and we are always looking for extra hosts. There is on-the-job training, and it is the best service project at the church where you meet everybody. So if you want to meet new people, that's the best spot to be. We do all the cake celebrations that you see out in the narthex, staff birthdays and staff recognition for years of service. And then we get asked to do cake celebrations for members' birthdays, 90th birthdays, and things like that. We'll have a chili cook-off in February. The Jingle Mingle is coming up on December 3rd, which is all members are invited to bring an appetizer or dessert to just hang out in the narthex all Christmas Eve for a couple hours. It's really also another good place to meet people. The summer picnic, the midweek meals, we clean the kitchen twice a year. And lastly, what Dave has mentioned is the Giving Thanks meal coming up next week. You can have a beautiful meal with 260 of your favorite newest members. So please come, please join the committee. We really do have a blast. We party at every committee meeting, and we party when we're all fellowship together getting ready for all the events. So join us.
I can attest to that. It's a party committee.
Okay. Additional ministries. Oh, what do you mean by that? I'm not sure. We do a lot of things. We do things outside the church. We do things inside the church. We participate with Circle of Concern, which is a food pantry in Valley Park. Isaiah House. When we have our big ABC sale, attic, basement, closet sale.
I was going to say, we founded a group, our minister from way back when, founded a group called Business People Between Jobs. Yeah. Back in the 80s, there were a couple members in the church, the economy got shaky, and there were members that lost their jobs and came to Howard for counseling. And he knew of a church in Chicago that was doing special programs for unemployed. So he started one here, and it grew and grew and grew until there were like 150 members coming every Monday morning. They were in this gym. You drive by the church and it looked like it was Easter or Christmas or something. And USA Today came and covered it, and I think CNN or something. It was quite a ministry. And it's still going on here every Monday morning. But it shrunk down to 20 or 30 because I think that there are other organizations doing it, and hopefully there aren't as many people unemployed, but there are volunteers from the church to help with that. And then we co-founded a shelter